Do you have my book here?
We got 10.
Yeah.
Well, she had 10 last time.
People. Oh, well. How much did you say it cost total?
I think that's $64.85.
Seemed like it was more than that.
$12.95 for the broadband farm.
Okay, for five.
They all cost the same.
Whoa, that's good. She did the, trying to, she kind of saw.
Did you include the tax?
Couple of cents, doesn't matter.
There's no tax, did you buy it here?
Oh, they don't, they didn't have tax though.
No tax? You ordered it?
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's freight. How much freight?
$2 total.
For the whole thing?
Yeah.
But no tax? Okay, $64.
$3. Almost $10. Small because it has more color. That's the way I do.
This person has a problem. This is the midwife. He brings it out. The process of bringing it out. And the other one just works in terms of material. And therefore, it's really within the person. I mean, another kind of problem is your own, where the person is literally seeing the world through their problem, and as it were in psychological language, projects it on the other. Mm-hmm. Right? That takes a little more skill to deal with it because they're putting it on the other party. Right? Then there can be much more interesting, and this is kind of very interesting. There's a higher problem, which is what we call the supra person. It has its origin not necessarily in something personal, right? Hence it's supra-personal, but if it goes beyond the personal, though it has sometimes its effect in one of these others. Always has its effect in these others, and only occasionally its origin in the others. Now, in the Theaetetus, as in all of these, the goal is to get it out. Right. Goal is to get it out, be able to look at it. So, we can now ask.
What's a super person?
It doesn't have its origin in either of these two cases. These are invariably taught by particular people and it's unknown. It's often taught and it can be recognized. It's not totally unknown. It can be discovered. It can be known. Origin can be known.
But how is it different? I understand.
Well, It, right? Its origin can be known. And it invariably takes someone accepting it, grounds for acceptance. The grounds for its acceptance can also be here. Now, it's this. How much work done, how much material is brought to the surface how much material is brought to the surface before the philosophical midwife can say the child of your soul has been delivered? In these cases, what do? We say we need examples. You've got to go for examples. Never go into the past before you can go into examples. And many others, you can see what the particular problem in many places, so you can see it coming out. And so you get an insight not to a particular circumstance and situation, but a whole class of insights. That's what you want. So, hiya, bunny. That's true. Yeah, did you bring your book too? Well, maybe we can get them. Right? So, let's go to 160D. Okay, 160D. So you were perfectly right in saying that knowledge is nothing but perceptual. And it's turned out that these three doctrines coincide. The doctrine of Homer, Heraclitus, and all their tribe, that all things move like flowing streams. The doctrine of Pythagoras, wisest of men, that man is the measure of all things. And Theaetetus' conclusion that on these grounds it results that perception is not. Is it not so, Theaetetus? May we say that this is your newborn child which I have brought to birth? What do you say? I can only agree, Socrates. Here at last, then, after our somewhat painful labor, is the child we have brought to birth, whatever sort of creature it may be. His birth should be followed by the ceremony of carrying him round the hearth. We must look at our offspring from every angle to make sure we are not taken in by a lifeless phantom not worth the rearing. Or do you think an infant of yours must be reared in any case and not exposed? Will you bear to see him put to the proof? And not be in a passion if your firstborn should be taken away? Okay, now.
And then from where he says he's suffering from the pangs of pregnancy, that's where it would begin then.
Well, Yeah, but what it is that he's suffering with, all right, let's introduce this characteristic for a moment. All right. That was pretty good. That was pretty good. That was pretty good. Do it again. See, what's been delivered, right, is this idea. Figuratively, we're showing it though. 151D. Well, Socrates, with such encouragement from a person like you, it would be a shame not to do one's best to say what one can. It seems to me that one who knows something is perceiving the thing he knows. And so far as I can see at present, knowledge is nothing but perception. Mm-hmm. Right? Nothing but perception. Now, I'm putting stress on that. Nothing but, you know. Well, how does yours go, please?
I think it's the same.
How about reading?
Nothing else bound. He comes around the back.
Pardon? Carol?
Nothing else bound. Knowledge is nothing else bound.
A shot!
No,
come on. Come here.
No, Bob. I would say the lobe is probably closer to... This is colloquial and therefore it's good. Right? That's colloquial and therefore it's good.
Give it to Mommy, Leah.
Nothing but...
Okay.
She just happened to be... She's a good basketball player.
She made 2 points in my coffee cup.
No,
with her shock.
Oh, kind of a...
More of a dump shot.
Junk shot.
Dump.
Okay, then look.
Shot.
What I'd like to see now is, what does it take between these two such that Socrates then can say, hey, the child of your soul has been delivered. What does it take? That would be parallel to, in these cases, finding present examples. Would it not? Finding present examples. So, right? If you're dealing with a supra-personal problem, this is a model. This is a model. And what he does between these two is to do just one thing. To try to show Theaetetus and the reader that this is wrong. Just to take away the nothing but, nothing else than.
She cast doubt on it, on the knowing?
Well, what do we mean when we say nothing but? It's nothing but.
It's only that.
Merely. Right, merely. Sometimes this takes on a very high-sounding name. It's called a reduction theory. If you can reduce something noble to something base, right, then that's the reduction theory.
Well, then, would you be doing it for the purpose of raising something else?
Would you be doing it?
In other words, reducing it so that you can have something else that's greater.
Oh.
He already does it.
Yeah, that's right. It's a hidden...
He doesn't have to do it.
It's a hidden form of criticism. When Freud developed the libido theory, he said, you can look at great works of art, they're nothing but the sublimation of sexual energy. So you take something lofty and reduce it down to some condition, material condition. Like, would you agree Beethoven's paintings? Well, I mean, his paintings. I mean, it's really nothing other than a bunch of oils and some color.
I didn't even know he painted.
Yeah. Right? Agree? I mean, it's nothing but that. The human body is nothing but the elements which can be sold at the marketplace for $1.97, as they used to say.
That's right.
Right, nothing but. See, that's nothing. What does that do? It's a reduction. It reduces it to its lowest level. Okay. And then you can dismiss it. There's nothing significant there. So, all right. If we go back now to 160D, all right, look what he did. All right, look what he did.
Well, it sure sounds a lot better.
Right, look what he did. He finally, look at the summary. All right, let's go back over the summary. What does he do?
Therefore, you require, right?
Homer, Heraclitus,
and all their followers.
And all the followers. And Theaetetus's position.
Is knowledge.
Right. And there he just says,
is knowledge.
Is knowledge. Right.
So it's all hanging out, right? On the line.
Okay, look here. He's saying, look here. If you take a look at this, if you want to do it right, if you want to do it right, tucked away in this, tucked away in behind it, are these two positions. And therefore, before we're going to deliver this child, we're going to have to make it all explicit. We're going to pull it all out. And when he finishes, well, let's do it now. You see what's left. Now, we can do a modern trip on this without any trouble.
Let me make one point. There's a way of looking at the term of midwifery that he's getting after the progenitor, the Protagoras. He's getting after the progenitor of the
Yeah, please.
Just he also characterizes that as the whole all philosophers accept, as yeah. Mr. Portman said, all philosophers accept Parmenides.
Yeah.
And all of the poets, I mean, all class, comic and tragic.
Yeah.
Is the progenitor Pythagoras or Theodorus?
What?
Is it Pythagoras or Theodorus?
Theodorus.
Theodorus. You said Pythagoras. You said Pythagoras.
Yeah, did Theaetetus know Protagoras?
Yes.
I'm just wondering, did he get it? Did he get it directly from Protagoras, or did he get it from Theodorus?
Well, his book. You've read that, I suppose.
But that didn't answer the question.
Well, yeah, that's true.
Right? Try it again. Hold on to his question.
Well, that's true. It didn't answer the question. Maybe I don't understand the force.
Yes, you did. Restate it. Try it.
It came off your statement. That's the force of it. He's the progenitor, you said, is Pythagoras. I made the comment, but what if it was Theodorus or Theodorus?
I'm talking about the living example.
Yes. I mean, it
don't have to be Theodorus.
The God enforced every day?
That's true.
Well, you want to settle it by logic?
How many? Yeah, because it's two, it's double, it's twice. It's Theodorus and teacher. Pythagoras is Theodorus' teacher. He said also that Pythagoras works straight. So it's like...
Anytime you can settle a question by appeal to a fact, you don't want to speculate on it. If you can't, that's not true.
Socrates says that he is the,
right.
He is the caretaker, that he is the caretaker of Pythagoras' work, and he says, no, it's Callias, it's not me, but But he is my friend, and he, you know, he certainly sounds like he has his... he doesn't want to admit to it.
Yeah, but your question is still a good one, which is, was there any direct relationship between Theotetus and Ptolemy?
Yeah, right.
Personal, yeah. At any point in his life?
And the answer is obviously no.
Why is it obviously?
Well, it's not obvious, because we don't know exactly what he does, do we?
No.
That's right. That's what he doesn't say. Okay. We don't know.
So therefore, that can be a textual question.
Yeah.
And if there isn't any comment on it, then we can explore possibilities.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. All right. How about it? We play and push to, this is now 9 pages of Stephanus Numbers. Right.
151.
Yeah.
Glad to read one.
Pardon?
Should I be glad to read one?
Okay, pick one. Another reader, please. You're on.
Which text do you have, Steve?
Well then, Socrates, since you are so urgent, it would be disgraceful for anyone not to exert himself in every way to save what he can. I think then that he who knows anything perceives that which he knows, and as it appears at present, knowledge is nothing else than perception.
Good, excellent, my boy. That is the way one ought to speak out. But come now, let us examine your utterance together and see whether it is a real offspring or a mere windbag. Perception, you say, is knowledge?
Yes.
And indeed, if I may venture to say so, it is not a bad description of knowledge that you have given, but one which Protagoras also used to give. Only he has said the same thing in a different way. For he says somewhere that man is the measure of all things, of the existence of the things that are and the non-existence of the things that are not. You have read that, I suppose?
Yes, I have read it often.
Well, is not this about what he means? That individual things are for me such as they appear to me, and for you, in turn, such as they appear to you, you and I being man.
Yes, that is what he said.
It is likely that a wise man is not talking nonsense, so let us follow after him. Is it not true that sometimes when the same wind blows, one of us feels cold and the other does not? Or one feels slightly and the other exceedingly cold?
Certainly.
Then in that case, shall we say that the wind is in itself cold or not cold? Or shall we accept Protagoras as saying that it is cold for him who feels cold and not for him who does not?
Apparently we shall accept that.
No.
Then it also seems cold or not to each of the two.
Yes.
But seems denotes perceiving.
It does.
Then seeming and perception are the same thing in matters of warmth and everything of that sort. For as each person perceives things, such they are to each person.
Apparently.
Perception, then, is always of that which exists, and since it is knowledge, cannot be false.
So it seems.
Right. First case. Right. Common experience. Right. Cites examples from common experience.
Thank you.
By the graces, I wonder if Protagoras, who was a very wise man, did not utter this dark saying to the common herd like ourselves and tell the truth in secret to his pupils.
Why, Socrates? What do you mean by that?
I will tell you, and it's not a bad description either, that nothing is one and invariable, and you could not rightly ascribe any quality whatsoever to anything. But if you call it large, it will also appear to be small, and light if you call it heavy. And everything else in the same way, since nothing whatever is one, either in a particular thing or of a particular quality,
But it is out of movement and motion and mixture with one another that all those things become which we wrongly say are. Wrongly, because nothing ever is, but is always becoming. And on the subject, and on this subject, all the philosophers, except Parmenides, may be marshaled in one line, Protagoras and Heraclitus and Empedocles, and the chief poets in the two kinds of poetry, Epicharmus in comedy and Homer in tragedy, who in the line, Oceanus, the origin of the gods, and Tethys, their mother, has said that all things are the offspring of flow and motion. Or don't you think he means that?
I think he does.
Then who could still contend with such a great host, led by Homer as general, and not make himself ridiculous?
It is not easy, Socrates.
No, Theaetetus, it is not. For the doctrine is amply proved by this, namely that motion is the cause of that which passes for existence, that is, of becoming, whereas rest is the cause of non-existence and destruction. For warmth or fire, which you know is the parent and preserver of all other things, is itself the offspring of movement and friction, and these two are forms of motion. Or are not these the source of fire?
Yes, they are.
And furthermore, the animal kingdom is sprung from these same sources.
Of course.
Well then, is not the bodily habit destroyed by rest and idleness and preserved, generally speaking, by gymnastic exercises and motions?
Yes.
And what of the habit of the soul? Does not the soul acquire information and is it not preserved and made better through learning and practice, which are motions? Whereas through rest, which is want of practice and of study, it learns nothing and forgets what it has learned.
Certainly.
Then the good, both for the soul and the body, is motion, and rest is the opposite.
Apparently.
Now, shall I go on and mention to you also windless air, calm sea, and all that sort of thing, and say that stillness causes decay and destruction, and that the opposite brings preservation? And shall I add to this the all-compelling and crowning argument that Homer, by the golden chain, refers to nothing else than the sun? It means that so long as the heavens and the sun go round, everything exists and is preserved. Among both gods and men, but if the motion should stop, as if bound fast, everything would be destroyed and would, as the saying is, be turned upside down.
Yes, Socrates, I think it means what you say does.
Okay. So, okay. What have you got so far? Let's get what we have. Okay, let's go back into those. Let's pick in that section.
Bye.
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 She don't want to go by.
Okay. I'm having so much fun here. A couple more coffee cups.
Are you having fun?
Okay, let's go back, shall we? Start at 152D. Indeed, the doctrine is a remarkable one. Say, nothing but? Nothing but? Nothing else then? Nothing else then? Hey, it's a remarkable. Remarkable doctrine. Now he's going to unfold. What's he doing first? It declares that nothing is one thing just by itself, or can you rightly call it by some definite name, or even say it is of any definite sort. On the contrary, if you call it large, we found it was small. Heavy, to be also light, and so on, though. Because nothing is one thing, or something, or any definite thing. All things, we're pleased to say, are really in a process of becoming, as a result of movement and change and a blending one with another. So we're wrong to speak of them as being, for none of them ever is. They're always becoming. So what's the first thing he knocks out? First thing he introduces? The fundamental principle of all things is becoming.
Yeah.
But first he gives you a fundamental principle.
And the difference between the two doctrines, the doctrines for the common herd and the doctrines for his private students, is to his students, then he says that the being is really becoming.
Yeah,
but the other way is that seeming and being and seeming, being and seeming are the same, being and perception are the same.
At this point, he's rejecting the idea of being.
Yeah, at that point.
Yeah. Okay, let's accept that, right? Fair enough? Then what does he do? A whole series of philosophers agree. Pythagoras, Heraclitus, Empedocles. Whole series of them.
Everybody but Parmenides.
Right. All but one is out on the other side. Look what he does next. And among the poets, the greatest masters of both kinds, Epicharmus and comedy, Homer and tragedy. So therefore, what do we have?
Divine animals.
The poets are regarded as divinely inspired seers. So he's saying, hey man, the basic root of your religions, right? Your religions. Right. Root of your religion, your dramas, right? Your religion. Right. In the modern world, we would say, well, if you go to physics and start out with physics, the whole universe, we now understand to a certain degree, it's coming into being at a certain rate, going through certain processes which physicists understand. And physicists that are also into chemistry, right?
Parmenides shows that view. Yeah.
So he's tying in the roots of your culture, religion, and tragedy and comedy, and all of these philosophers, right? All philosophers minus one.
All religious systems.
Right? Minus one.
Damn.
What I'm interested in is the next line. When Homer speaks of Oceana, source of the gods, mother of Titus, he means that all things are the offspring of a flowing stream of change. What does that mean to a contemporary?
It's your religion.
Yeah. Your mythology, right? Your basic mythology of the gods, the source of all your gods.
The Garden of Eden.
Right, the source of the gods. Nothing other than change, becoming. So, well, he's elevating that first principle, isn't he? Right, you got to have it, isn't it?
Yeah, knowledge is nothing else but perception.
Yeah.
He's really upping the ante, though. If this falls, you see one has to fall.
So, if we were to say that, if we could build it this way, and say that what we have here, we've got as a whole, all the philosophers, we've got a lot at stake coming down
you
here.
You bet.
And it all rests upon a fundamental notion. Just a couple of fundamental notions, that's all.
Interesting.
And therefore, if that's attacked,
the whole thing falls.
And that's Greek culture. It's Greek culture. He's putting it all in there. He's saying, hey, look, come on, let me give it to you all.
Right? It gives comical in the way.
All your philosophy, all your tragedy, all your comedy, Homer, all of that tribe.
But Theaetetus gets interested in that.
Who then could challenge so great an array with Homer for its captain and not make himself a laughing stock? Right? There he is. There he is, Homer. Right. Who could challenge such a group? Nobody. It would be a laughing stock to try to take all those people on.
Well,
Okay, from 153A, all right, what do you see he's doing now? What is he adding? All right, let's take some of this stuff off, make it alone.
Existence and non-existence.
Well, what's he got? He's got two categories. What are the two
principal
categories? That's right. Being and becoming. The source of them both. See what he's saying? Yeah, the source of both. The fundamental characters. The fundamental concepts. Their doctrine that being and becoming are produced by motion. Not being, perishing by rest. Right. So what does he do? He reduces the whole thing to
motion and rest.
Motion and rest.
Well, that sounds different than. I think you could read differently than both.
And of the two, what's of the two, the most significant, of course, is motion.
Motion, sure.
We're more interested in the existent than the non-existent. Mm-hmm.
Then what does he do? He provides what he calls proofs. Heat, source of life. Heat, source of life. That too, you have to admit, produced by friction, some kind. Produced by, generated by movement and friction. Yeah. They're both forms of change. All forms, source of all life. Right. It's expanding. The guy's really going for broke, isn't he? And further, all living things are born by the same concept. E. All right, now what does he do? Goes through a couple of categories, doesn't he? First, body, and then soul, doesn't he? Okay? Good heavens, we'd like to read it. I'm doing more work than I should. Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Let's see. How can you think this is not? The doctrine is amply proved by this. Namely, that motion is the cause of that which passes for existence, that is, of becoming. Whereas rest is the cause of non-existence and destruction. The warmth of fire, which you know is the parent and preserver of all things, is itself the offspring of movement and friction. And these two are forms of motion. Or are not these a source of fire?
Yes, they are.
And furthermore, the animal kingdom is sprung from these same sources.
Of course.
Well then, is not the bodily habit destroyed by rest and idleness, and preserved, generally speaking, mm-hmm. by gymnastic exercises and motions?
Right. So that's the next category, right? Take a look at the body. Inactivity is to indolence, is a consequence of rest. The body in good shape is activity, exercise.
Pretty good arguments.
Right, therefore, health. Right. So on one side you have health, the other side you have disease. Or degeneracy of one kind or another.
Sure.
All right, he's pulling that in too. All right, how about on the level of soul? Keep going.
And what of the habit of the soul? Does not the soul acquire information, and is it not preserved and made better through learning and practice, which are motion?
Right, learning itself is motion.
That's right. Well. Whereas through rest, which is want, practice, and obsession, it learns nothing and forgets what it has learned.
Certainly.
Right, so, right, you get forgetfulness and the loss of learning. That's rest. Learning. Motion. Good old motion. So he's doing well, isn't he? Uh-huh.
Then the good both for the soul and the body is motion, and rest is the opposite.
Apparently.
Now shall I go on and mention to you also windless air, calm sea, and all that sort of thing, and say that stillness causes decay and destruction, and that the opposite brings preservation? And shall I add to this the all-compelling and crowning argument that Homer, by the golden chain, refers to nothing else than the sun, and means that so long as the heavens and the sun go around, everything exists and is preserved among both gods and men? That if the motion to stop, as if bound fast, everything would be destroyed.
Right. Once the sun turns off, once the sun stops in the heavens, and we stop moving, it's all over. Right? Whole cosmos, it's a cosmic principle now. He's all right for cosmic principle.
Reality of the cause of the motion.
Right, it's a cosmic principle the guy's picking up now.
Yes, Socrates, I think he means what you said he does.
Let my friend open, yeah. This would be good for
him. Okay. Right? New level now. All right, now he goes for precision. He wants to now, look, he's going to add precision to this position. He's going to go back into it, redefine it. That's what he's going to start doing now. So we have, all right, look at that, quickly. All right, what's he doing? Well, he has this popular example, which everyone is familiar with in terms of the senses. Wind blowing, to you it feels chilly, to me it's slightly chilly. Who's right? The person who experiences it, right? They're infallible. They know how they feel, and they can make judgments about they feel, about what they feel. And the wind certainly exists. Therefore, that's infallible knowledge, you say. Right? And who can say, no, that I don't feel chilly when I feel chilly? And you, slightly chilly, but you don't feel slightly chilly. Right? Infallible knowledge. Then he goes back, and he gives it to Protagoras, in conclusion, there, things are to be such a period of need, you're such a period of need. So he says, hey, this is really a remarkable doctrine. Fundamental principle of becoming. Right? Then he pulls in religion, all the philosophers, mythology, tragedy, comedy, the roots of religion, throws that in. Wait, then he goes back to source of the gods, the very source of the gods, source of life. Being and becoming really aren't fundamental. It's really motion and rest. Why, good heavens, you can find that in the soul and in the body, as well as in the cosmos. Filling it out, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's filling it out. Okay, new level? Okay, new level.
Then, my friend, you must apply the doctrine in this way. First, as concerns vision, the color that you call white is not to be taken as something separate outside of your eyes, nor as yet as something inside of it. And you must not assign any place to it, for then it would at once be in a definite position and stationary, and would have no part of the process of becoming.
What do you mean?
Let us stick close to the statement we made a moment ago and assume that nothing exists by itself as invariably one. Then it will be apparent that black or white or any color whatsoever is the result of the impact of the eye upon the appropriate motion. And therefore, that which we call color will be in each instance neither that which impinges nor that which is impinged upon, but something between, which has occurred peculiar to each individual.
Look, this object has a color. No, it doesn't. Light strikes it, and what happens? It literally bounces off the, has a certain wavelength, does it not?
In the air. Right. Or somewhere between.
Right. Somewhere between. And the eyes, as vision goes out to contact the object, encounters it somewhere in between those. Mm-hmm. See what he's doing? He's making it consistent with chaos in motion. Mm-hmm. So he's taking knowledge as perception and saying, wait a minute, I've got news for you. We have to reconcile this with the other elements.
That's right.
And that's what he's doing.
Well, remarkable thing is that by reasoning from the principle of emotion, he has anticipated the experimental conclusions that modern science has made about theory of perception.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's true. Okay.
Well, I thought it was remarkable.
Yeah, okay. No, I didn't knock it. I didn't knock it.
But the thing is, that the important thing is he's got it really solidified now, and there can't be any exceptions to it. He's got it rolling. So when you start being precise, it's going to fall apart.
Well, what's up is in there?
Because nothing can be. You can't say anything else.
We need just one more thing as we proceed. Go ahead.
Or would you maintain that each color appears to a dog or any other animal to be just as it does to you?
No, Pisces, I wouldn't.
And as you know, I'm very good at drawing cats. Same thing is going to be true for...
How in the world would you know that?
No.
Things are to me such a degree of you, such a degree. Who's going to say therefore things appear to you the same way it appears to a cat or a dog or anything else?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, does anything whatsoever appear the same to any other man as to you? Are you sure of this? Or are you not much more convinced that nothing appears the same even to you? Because you yourself are never exactly the same.
Yes, much more convinced of that.
Right, you yourself. Are you going to change?
Yeah.
Right. This is in flux. That's in flux. Here's right. Whole thing is in flux. All emotion.
This next one would probably be good to get another translation too.
Oh, right. Okay, good.
Then, if that with which I compare myself in size, or which I touch, were really large, or white, or hot, it would never have become different by coming in contact with something different without a self changing. Oh, okay, that's going back to me. Mm-hmm. And if, on the other hand, that which did the comparing or the touching were really large or white or hot, it would not have become different when something different approached it or was affected in some way by it without being affected in some way itself. For nowadays, my friend, we find ourselves rather easily forced to make extraordinary and absurd statements, as Protagoras and everyone who undertakes to agree with him would say.
What do you mean? What statements?
Take a little example, and you will know all I have in mind. Given six dice, for instance, if you compare four with them, we say that they are more than the four, half as many again. But if you compare 12 of them, we say that they are less, half as many. And any other statement would be inadmissible. Or would you admit any of them?
Not I.
Well then, if Protagoras or anyone else asked you, Theaetetus, can anything become greater or more in any other way than by being increased? What reply would you make?
If I am to say what I think, Socrates, with reference to the present question, I should say no. But if I consider the earlier questions, I should say yes, for fear of contradicting myself.
Good, by Hera, excellent, my friend. But apparently, if you answer yes, it will be in the Euripidean spirit, for your tongue will be unconvinced, but not your mind.
True.
Well, if you and I were clever and wise and had found out everything about the mind, we should henceforth spend the rest of our time testing each other out of the fullness of our wisdom, rushing together like sophists in a sophistical combat, battering each other's arguments with counter-arguments. But as it is, since we are ordinary people, we shall wish in the first place to look into the real essence of our thoughts and see whether they harmonize with one another or not at all.
How many points do you get there?
Boy.
Make sure you got them. Say, what is he now doing? New level. What's he now doing?
He's raising.
He brought about the first contradiction.
Right. In other words, now there's a body of information which we accept Right? There's a body of information we accept. Or we might call it a body of data, which doesn't fit this. Therefore, what is he going to do? He has to show a way in which you can reconcile all of this with the theory. Mm-hmm. And that's what he's doing. He says, look, I can take that. I'll show you how to do that. And we get a whole bunch of them. And that's why they call this the puzzles. Right? Reconciling all the puzzles. Right? So there's a body of data. Right? That's at variance with the theory. And he's going to reconcile it otherwise. So, you know, very cool thing. So he's giving it what they call scope. Right? He's going to broaden it, include everything significant. Right? He's giving it scope, it's called. Precision and scope, two things you need for every theory.
And so should I. But since this is the case, and we have plenty of time, shall we not quietly, without any impatience, but truly examining ourselves, consider again the nature of these appearances within us? And as we consider them, I shall say, I think, first, that nothing can ever become more or less in size or number so long as it remains equal to itself. Is it not so?
Yes.
And secondly, that anything to which nothing is added and from which nothing is subtracted is neither increased nor diminished, but is always equal.
Certainly.
And should we not say thirdly that what was not previously could not afterwards be without becoming and having become?
Yes, I agree.
These three assumptions contend with one another in our minds when we talk about the dice, or when we say that I, who do not at my age either increase in size or diminish, am in the course of a year first larger than you who are young, and afterwards smaller, when nothing has been taken from my size, but you have grown. Or I am, it seems, afterwards what I was not before, and I have not become so. For it is impossible to have become without becoming, or without losing anything of my size, I could not become smaller. And there are countless myriads of such contradictions if we are to accept these that I have mentioned. You follow me, I take it, Theaetetus, for I think you are not new at such things.
Come to God, Socrates, I'm lost in wonder when I think of all these things, and sometimes when I regard them, it really makes my head swim.
Theodorus seems to be a pretty good guesser about your nature. For this feeling of wonder shows that you are a philosopher, since wonder is the only beginning of philosophy. And he who said that Iris was a child of Thaumas made a good genealogy. But do you begin to understand why these things are so, according to the doctrine we attribute to Pythagoras? Or do you not as yet?
Not yet, I think.
And will you be grateful to me if I help you?
Okay, what you got to do?
Sure.
Do you now begin to see the explanation of all this, which follows from the theory we are attributing to Pythagoras? Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's going to reconcile it all. Mm-hmm. Where's the reconciling? Mm-hmm. I can't say it yet. You know, I can't say it yet.
And will you be grateful to me if I help you to search out the hidden truth of the thought of a famous man, or, I should say, a famous man?
Of course I shall be grateful, very grateful.
Look round and see that none of the uninitiated is listening. The uninitiated are those who think that nothing is except what they can grasp firmly in their hands, and who deny the existence of actions and generation and all that is invisible.
Truly, Socrates, those who speak of are very stubborn and perverse mortals.
So they are, my boy, quite without culture. But others are more clever, whose secret doctrines I am going to disclose to you. For them, the beginning upon which all the things we were just now speaking of depend is the assumption that everything is really motion, and that there is nothing besides this, but that there are two kinds of motion, each infinite in the number of its manifestations. And of these kinds, one has an active, the other a passive force. From the union and friction of these two are born offspring, infinite in number, but always twins, the object of sense and the sense which is always born and brought forth together with the object of sense. Now we give the senses names like the sight and hearing and smell, and the sense of cold and appease and pleasures and pains and desires and fears and so forth. Those that have names are very numerous, and those that are unnamed are innumerable. Now, the class of objects of sense is akin to each of these. All sorts of colors are akin to all sorts of acts of vision. And in the same way, sounds to acts of hearing. And the other objects of sense spring forth akin to the other senses. What does this tale mean for us, Theaetetus, with reference to what was said before? Do you see?
Not quite, Socrates.
Okay, what did he just do? He had two principles before, didn't he? Didn't it?
Yeah,
motion. Two kinds of
motion. He's saying, hey, the truth of this, it's just motion. Two kinds of motion. You grasp that, then we can go back to these puzzles and write them out.
What's the difference in something being infinite and, very numerous? Those that have names are very numerous, and those that are unnamed are innumerable. Mm-hmm. Is there any difference in that? Sounds the same to me.
There's always another reason to go back to the doctor.
All right, go ahead. Do it again.
For then the beginning upon which all the things we were just now speaking of depend. His assumption that everything is really motion, and that there is nothing besides it. But that there are two kinds of motion, each infinite in the number of its manifestations. And of these kinds, one has an active, the other a passive force. From the union and friction of these two are born offspring, infinite in number, but always twins, the object of sense, and the sense which is always born and brought forth together with the object of sense. Now we give.
Keep going, Bishop. Read the next line.
Okay. Now we give the senses names like the sight and hearing and smell.
Oh, yeah. From the intercourse and friction of these with one another arise offspring, endless in number, but in pairs of twins. One of each pair is something perceived. The other is perception. That's the point. Mm-hmm. Whose birth always coincides with that of the thing perceived. Whose birth always coincides with that of the thing perceived. Right. Now watch the ing flipping through this now. Now for the perceptions. Now he takes that first. Seeing, hearing, smelling, feeling cold, feeling hot, and again pleasures and pains and desires and fears as they are called, and so on.
Keeping it emotional.
There are any number that are nameless. The names have been found for a whole multitude. They're all your experiences, INGs.
Yeah, it's a little different. A little.
On the other side, the brood of things perceived always comes to birth at the same moment with one of another of these, with instances of seeing, colors of corresponding variety, with instances of hearing, sounds the same way, and with all the other perceptions, the other things perceived that are akin to them. You have ing, which is really all the different ways of perceiving, all of the different ways of perceiving or experiencing, right?
Keeping it in motion.
Right, that's right. Keeps it in motion. All the experiencing, right, only comes into existence when it reaches out and contacts some object. Right? Hearing doesn't take place unless there's something heard. Right? They go together. Each one of these INGs always go together. touching doesn't take place unless there's some object that's touched. They're spring together. Don't they? So. One of each pair is something perceived, right? That's the objects. And the other is the activity that engages it. One active, one passive. Need both. Need both.
This is a Protagoras. Yeah. This is language of Protagoras.
Yeah, yeah.
So therefore, this is a... This is the bird.
Yeah, well, he's going to introduce a whole theory of sense perception. Which is where he's going. Okay, all right? On the one side, the brood of things perceived. A whole bunch of stuff. Always comes to birth. The same moment. With one or another of these. With instances of ing. And what do we know about the object from before? It's in motion, and its effects are floating from the object. Color isn't inherent in the object. It's a phenomenon that takes place when the light strikes an object and bounces off the object, which is then perceived somewhere between the eye and the object. You never see the object, all you see is color. The color is somewhere hanging on the object. So he says, hey, you dig this? And Theaetetus comes back with the immortal words.
Not very clearly.
Not quite.
Huh? You mind running that back over again, Sock?
Yeah. You mean that's what I admitted to at the beginning?
That goes back to the principle. Let's go. Okay.
Just listen. Perhaps we can finish the tale. It means, of course, that all these things are, as you were saying, emotion. And the motion has in it either swiftness or slowness. Now the slow element keeps its motion in the same place and directed towards such things as draw near it. And indeed it is in this way that it begins. But the things begotten in this way are quicker, for they move from one place to another, and their motion is naturally from one place to another. Now, when the eye and some appropriate object which approaches beget whiteness and the corresponding perception, which could never have been produced by either of them going to anything else, then while the sight from the eye and whiteness from that which happens to produce the color are moving from one to the other, the eye becomes full of sight, and so begins at that moment to see and becomes certainly not sight, but a seeing eye. And the object which joined in beginning the color is filled with whiteness, and becomes in its turn not whiteness, but white, whether it be a stick, or stone, or whatever it be, the hue of which is so colored. And all the rest, hard and hot and so forth, must be regarded in the same way. We must assume, we said before, that nothing exists in itself, but all things of all sorts arise out of motion by intercourse with each other. For it is, as they say, impossible to form a firm conception of the active or the passive element as being anything separately. For there is no active element until there is a union with the passive element. Nor is there a passive element until there is a union with the active. And that which unites with one thing is active and appears again as passive when it comes in contact with something else. And so it results from all this, as we said in the beginning, that nothing exists invariably one, itself by itself, but everything is always becoming in relation to something. And being should be altogether abolished, though we have often, and even just now, been compelled by custom and ignorance to use the word. But we ought not, the wise men say, to permit the use of something, or somebody's, or mine, or this, or that, or any other word that implies making things stand still. But in accordance with nature, we should speak of things as becoming, and being made, and being destroyed, and changing. For anyone who by his mode of speech makes things stand still is easily refuted. And we must not use such expressions in relation both. And we must use such expressions in relation both to particular objects and collective designations, among which are mankind and stone, and the names of every animal in class. Do these doctors seem pleasant to you at the theaters? And do you find their taste agreeable?
See what the guy's doing? He's rethinking the whole thing.
I have no Socrates. Besides, I can't tell about you either. Whether you are preaching them because you believe them or to test me.
Yes, my friend.
I've never experienced that before.
Pardon?
I said, well, I've never experienced that before, have you?
No.
Wondering if someone was preaching or testing?
No.
Completely foreign.
She's being so facetious.
I certainly am.
I can't even spell it.
And the preacher and testers in this room are wondering, the wondering.
I can't spell it.
What, preacher?
Facetious. No,
whole.
Yeah.
It's not a super personal problem, is it?
What, spelling facetious?
No wonder.
You forget, my friend.
Yes.
I know nothing of such matters. I'm not claiming to be producing any offspring of my own.
Don't knock it.
I'm only trying to deliver yours. And to that end, uttering charms over you and tempting your appetite with a variety of delicacies from the table of wisdom. Until, by my aid, your own belief shall be brought to life. Once that's done, I shall see whether it proves to have some life in it or not. Meanwhile, have courage and patience in answering my questions bravely in accordance with your conviction. Good. Said, in the art of midwifery, we talked about midwifery, did the idea of charms play a role?
Mm-hmm.
Then we can go back, and for every item, we can check them off, you know, to see whether we can find examples throughout the whole work.
That's right.
Because each of the points that was attributed to the midwife, therefore it's parallel with philosophical midwife.
Because he makes them explicit as he goes.
Louder?
He makes them explicit as he goes. Or says,
yeah,
there.
Yeah. Clever work.
Except for cutting the umbilical cord.
Did you hear that? Neither did I, but I didn't want to say because, you know, I know that.
But he's got to do that, doesn't he?
He has to, otherwise it's
going, otherwise it's going to be connected to the guy.
Cut that.
Right? Can't take the offspring from him if he doesn't cut the cord.
Yes, it's kind of your doctor to make this up.
Okay, we push. We have Theotetus' great line.
Go on with your questioning. Farewell. Ask away. I give you both love.
Get some more,
Gift.
Let's say once more. Whether the doctrine pleases you that nothing is, but is always becoming good or beautiful or any of the other qualities we were just enumerating.
Boy, when I heard you telling about it, as you did, it seems to me that it is wonderfully reasonable and ought to be accepted as you have presented.
Let us then not neglect a point in which it is defective. The defect is found in connection with dreams and diseases, including insanity and everything else.
And push it all away. Wait a while. We got to put in more. We're not going to. We have to finish.
Okay, that's what I was
going to say. Insane man's opinion.
Stop now.
Hey, it was real good up to that point. Let's leave this out.
Okay, it's building. It's building. Yes. Everything else that is said to cause illusion of sight and hearing and the other senses. For of course, you know that in all these, the doctrine we were just presenting seems admittedly to be refuted, because in them we certainly have false perceptions, and it's by no means true that everything is to each man which appears to him. On the contrary, nothing is which appears.
What you say is very true, Socrates.
What argument is left then, my boy? For the man who says that perception is knowledge, and that in each case the things which appear are to the one to whom they appear.
I hesitate to say, Socrates, that I have no reply to make, because you scolded me just now when I said that, but really I cannot dispute that those who are insane or dreaming have false opinions. When some of them think they are gods, and others fancy in their sleep that they have wings and are flying.
Therefore, the theory, in terms of citing these kinds of cases, cannot deal with it, doesn't have sufficient scope. Or he has to deal with it, doesn't he?
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Don't you remember either a similar dispute about these errors, especially about sleeping and waking?
What dispute?
One which I fancy you have often heard. The question is asked, what proof you could give, if anyone should ask us now, at the present moment, whether we are asleep and our thoughts are a dream, or whether we are awake and talking with each other in a waking condition?
Really, Socrates, I don't see what proof can be given, for there is an exact correspondence in all particulars, as between the strophe and the antistrophe of the choral song. Take, for instance, the conversations we have just had. There is nothing to prevent us from imagining in our sleep that we are carrying on this conversation with each other. And when in a dream we imagine that we are relating dreams, the likeness between the one talk and the other is remarkable.
So you see, it is not hard to dispute the point, since it is even open to dispute whether we are awake or in a dream. Now, since the time during which we are asleep is equal to that during which we are awake, we slept 12 hours. In each state, our spirit contends that the semblance that appears to it at any time are certainly true. So that for half the time we say that this is true, and for half the time the other. We maintain each with equal confidence.
Certainly.
And may not then the same be said about insanity and the other diseases, except that the time is not equal?
Yes.
Well then, shall truth be determined by the length or shortness of time?
That would be absurd in many ways.
But can you show clearly in any other way which of the two sets of opinions is true?
I do not think I can.
Listen then, when I tell you what would be said about them by those who maintain that what appears at any time...
When does he give the views?
After he has cited all of it.
And after the person says, I don't know. Yeah. I can't do it.
That's right.
That's right. Right? I can't.
Well, he needs a correspondent. He needs someone to dialogue with.
Yeah.
That's right.
I can't do it. He says, okay, I'll tell you. Always gives him a chance. Because we're just as good coming from him.
Listen then, will I tell you what would be said about them by those who maintain that what appears at any time is true for him to whom it appears? They begin, I imagine, by asking this question. Theaetetus, can that which is wholly other have in any way the same quality as its alternative? And we must not assume that the thing in question is partially the same, partially other, but wholly other.
It is impossible for it to be the same in anything, either in quality or in any other respect whatsoever, when it is wholly other.
You've read the book well. Must we not then necessarily agree that such a thing is also unlike?
Seems so to me.
But if anything happens to become like or unlike anything, either itself or anything else, we shall say that when it becomes like, it becomes the same. And when it becomes unlike, it becomes other.
We must.
Well, we said before, did we not, that the active elements were many, infinite in fact, and likewise the passive elements?
Yes.
For the more than any given element, by uniting at different times with different partners, will we get not the same with other results?
Certainly.
Well then, let us take me, or you, or anything else at hand, and apply the same principle. Say Socrates and health, and Socrates and illness. Shall we say the one is like the other, or unlike?
When you say Socrates and illness, do you mean to compare that Socrates as a whole with Socrates and health as a whole?
Talk with Sophist. You understand perfectly. That is just what I mean.
Unlike, I imagine.
And therefore other, inasmuch as unlike?
Necessarily.
And you would say the same of Socrates asleep, or in any of the other states we enumerated just now?
Yes.
That each of those elements which by the law of their nature act upon something else will, when it gets hold of Socrates and health, find me one object to act upon. And when it gets a hold of me in illness, another?
How can it help it?
And so... In the two cases, that active element and I, who am the passive element, shall each produce a different object?
Of course.
So then, when I am in health and drink wine, it seems pleasant and sweet to me?
Yes.
reason is, in fact, that according to the principles that we accepted a while ago, the active and passive elements produce sweetness and perception, both of which are simultaneously moving from one place to another. And the perception which comes from the passive element makes the tongue perceptive, and the sweetness which comes from the wine and pervades it passes over and makes the wine both to be and to seem sweet to the tongue which is an element.
Certainly. Such are the principles we accepted a while ago.
But when it gets hold of me and Ellis in the first place, it doesn't really get hold of the same man, does it? For he to whom it comes is certainly alive.
True.
Therefore, the union of the Socrates who is ill in the draught of wine produces other results. In the tongue, the sensation of or perception of bitterness, and in the wine, a bitterness which is engendered there and passes over into the other. The wine is made not bitterness, but bitter, and I am made not perception, but perceptive.
Certainly.
Thank you very much. Applaud.
One more step.
They start applauding. Huh? Then I shall never have this perception of any other thing. For a perception of another thing is another perception. It makes a percipient different than another. Nor can that which acts on me ever by union with another produce the same result.
Or a person who is in a different condition is a different person.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. An other. Mm-hmm. Not the same.
They're not the same.
So dreaming versus being awake.
Different sense.
Different. So you're different. See, I really am. Than you were just 2 seconds ago.
And therefore, it is to you as you perceive. Right. Because you're different.
Right. At that moment, yeah. You're different than you were before.
This is what it was like to.
So then nothing is ever the same.
Nothing ever the same. So therefore, it fits in the theory.
Uh-huh. So far.
This is what it was like hearing Greek teaching.
You didn't hear that.
I don't know that part about the dreaming and awake, though. We didn't solve that one.
We'll go back, okay? Just why we go through all
this. I shall never have this perception of any other thing. For a perception of another thing is another perception. It makes a percipient different than another. Nor can that which acts on me ever by union with another produce the same result or become the same in kind. For by producing another result from another passive element, it will become different in kind.
That is true.
And neither shall I, furthermore, ever again become the same as I am, nor will that ever become the same as it is.
Nope.
Because it's a pair, right? I am G, I'm an object. If I become different, so I have a different experience. Look at further, I shall not come to have this sensation for myself, nor will the object come to be of such a quality for itself, because it always requires two.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's fine.
But then they'd be, that's further on. But they can never be.
It is, that's a great line.
No.
And yet, when I become percipient, I must necessarily become percipient of something. For it is impossible to become percipient and perceive nothing. And that which is perceived must become so for someone. When it becomes sweet or bitter or the like. When it becomes sweet but sweet to no one is impossible.
Because they come together. Sweetness doesn't exist in isolation from someone who's tasted the sweetness.
That's right. So. The result then, I think, is that we, the active and the passive elements, are to become whichever is the case in relation to one another. Since we are bound to one another by the inevitable law of our being, but to nothing else, not even to ourselves.
Wow, what are you saying?
What are you saying?
Back up. Come
on. The result, then, I think, is that we, the active or the passive elements, are to become whichever is the case in relation to one another, since we are bound to one another by the inevitable law of our being, but to nothing else, not even to ourselves. We're not bound to ourselves. Therefore, we don't exist unless we're perceiving.
You got it. Nothing remains. Then,
but being is becoming, isn't it?
That's right. Being is becoming. Nothing remains then, I suppose. But that it and I should be or become. Whichever expression we are to use for each other. Necessity binds
together our existence, that binds neither of us to anything else, or each of us to himself. So, we can only be bound to one another accordingly. Whether we speak of something being, or of its becoming, we must speak of it as being or becoming for someone, or of something, or towards something. We must not speak or allow others to speak of it, of a thing as either being or becoming anything just in and by itself. That's the conclusion for which our argument points.
It's only in pairs.
So all of the thing in itself is out.
That's right. When you teach that, you're teaching people not to reflect, not to remember, not to think. Right? When they're teaching, they know what they're trying to do.
The Adjutant has the great line.
Certainly, Scott.
That's really good, some great line.
That says that which acts on me is to me and to me only. It is also the case that I perceive it, and I only.
Of course.
And to me, my perception is true. For in each case, it is always part of my being. And I am, as Pythagoras says, the judge of the existence of the things which are to me, and of the non-existence of those that are not to me.
So it seems.
Then my perception is true for me, for its object at any moment is my reality. And I am, as Pythagoras says, a judge of what is for me, that it is, and of what it is not, that it is not. So it appears to me.
Just sure. Ask me.
How then, if I am an infallible judge, and my mind never stumbles in regard to the things that are or that become, can I fail to know that which I perceive?
You cannot possibly fail.
Therefore, you were quite right in saying that knowledge is nothing else than perception. There was complete identity between the doctrines of Homer and Heraclitus and all other followers. But all things are in motion like streams. The doctrine of the great philosopher Pythagoras, that man is the measure of all things. The doctrine of Theaetetus, that since these things are true, perception is knowledge. Yea, Theaetetus? Shall we say that this is, so to speak, your newborn child and the result of my midwifery? Or what shall we say?
I must say that, huh?
Right, so, go back to our question. What does it take to give to birth on a supra-personal thought?
You got to find the origin, right? You got to go back to the origin. Find all the...
You have to see it everywhere. You have to build the theory so that it has, as they say, great scope, includes everything. Now when you attack it, what's at stake?
Everything. It all has to fall, like a car, a house of cards.
Right. Everything. And he won't play the game of logic. So he doesn't pursue logic. He doesn't say, oh, well, if you think that's true, let me show you an argument. No. Pulls it all out, doesn't it? Much more than the kid thought he had in himself. Look here. It's what he's doing. All right. He's letting them see how much is there.
They're in charge.
Yeah. That's what he's doing, isn't it? Right? He's bringing it all out. Now, it's out.
What a baby.
Yeah, right. So if someone wanted to play it in the modern world, wouldn't it be interesting to take a position and say, okay, from anthropology, from biology, from physics, from chemistry, from history, pull it all together, from every viewpoint, pull it all out. And you have that whole package, and you take a quiz. A good evening to do it, and then you say, okay, now your child is born. Now you want to take a look at it? All right, give it depth. All right, what does that do to this nothing but we had on the board?
It really makes it huge.
Knowledge is nothing but perception.
And perception is airy fairy. I mean, you know.
Pretty big now. Mm-hmm. Major.
Well, you have the whole religious system, the whole cultural system.
all the experts in the field. Mm-hmm. I mean, the whole culture is riding on this point.
The game would be to approach all the experts in terms of a dialogue about the origins of the system in terms of perception.
Yeah. Isn't that their parallel too on the interpersonal, where you have the many different examples of your problem in your life and the many ways it shows itself in your speech, in your relationship, in your job, in your study, in the way you dress, in the way you talk, in the way you
I'd like to see them some. The way that somebody ran through tapes, you know, what does that do when you view you on tape? Something happens in it. Like, okay, I'm also carrying the position, exhibiting it in some way.
Oh, yeah.
Like, far more sophisticated.
Yeah, you can say, boy, I can see right there, I knew that. Boy, I knew that right there. See, I didn't even hear what the guy said. I knew it right there. Yeah, that's interesting.
What do I need to know?
Time?
Yes. What time is it?
9:15.
What?
10 after 9. Oh, anybody got 9 o'clock? 8:30.
No way. But now it does seem like he's gone into the past here, hasn't he? I mean, he's gone into origin.
Not personal.
Not as if you went in and saw the origin of your family problem or where you learned it.
That's right.
Right.
It's cultural.
Cultural.
It's cultural.
Larger expanse.
Well, we could say if we just changed it a bit. We'd say that. This is a view that you can see in your religion. Right? You can see it in the movies and in comedy, in tragedy, in the theater.
Mm-hmm. The nature of God.
Right. In theology.
Mm-hmm. In politics.
In politics, right. You can see it everywhere. Right? You have to pull one out of the person.
So he just goes through all that and says, bang, right? Because all that else will fall with it.
That's right. That's what he's after.
There's no use to bring all that out.
Yeah, he's not after this, right? Knowledge of perception.
No, of course.
Logically, it'd be a very simple thing to do. What we have to do is say, obviously, this is absurd.
Sure.
Right? Because there's no knowledge in a perception. Right? Where is the perceiver? Here? Right? That's the boundary of the perceiver?
Mm-hmm.
What's the boundary of the perceived? The edge of the box?
Mm-hmm.
Where is the perception between the two?
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, you can never have any knowledge.
Out there.
That's right. You never get in. It can't get to the thing, and get to the perceiver.
No. Therefore, it's absurd. He could do that. He does it. Very simple. That's not what he's after. He's not after a logical system.
Yeah, he does that in there.
He's not after that.
No.
He wants to pull it all out. Get the whole culture behind it, everything behind it.
Just it seems also before he makes it precise in terms of the details of the theory, he takes the common language we talked about it like as less precise, but it's almost as if it's common expressions of the culture, you know, as Homer calls it, the golden chain, and it's so it's like there's no ground on which that idea can remain. You know, it's almost like the bumper sticker. You know, you think you can prove it here in these ways and by introducing these arguments of. It being the cause of life and of all these kinds of things, well, dresses it in those clothes as well.
Yeah. So, Graham, what does it take on that level?
Hanging everywhere.
So, that means you have to be well informed about your culture. Like to play the game, it means that you have to do your own homework. Right. You have to see the ideas that are culturally bankrupt, that are having a profound effect on your fellow man's life.
So then you're placed in the position of having an overview? You're able to look?
Well, to play the game, the midwife has to have a sufficient view of what's going on in his culture to play this. And be able to give the best statement of it. This, would you agree there's no straw man argument here? Right? He doesn't create a weak a weak position. He builds
it. No, he gives it all the strength he can muster. Right. I mean, he defends it probably better than most people could, especially later on.
And the whole thing falls in one paragraph.
Yeah.
The whole thing falls in one paragraph. And then after it falls, what does he do? He says, hey, wait a minute. We weren't being fair. Let's build it up again. So he builds it up again.
He said, you know, Socrates can come up above the head, right? He would say, hey, you're talking to a mere boy. Now, he does a couple of things there. He gets Theodorus in there with him.
Yeah, pulls the teacher in.
That's right.
Yeah. That's where it starts getting here.
That's right.
That's where it starts.
He's going to
see. Let's see where you got this. Let's pull in your teacher.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's see.
You're going to make me strip, huh, Socrates?
Yep, that's right. So.
But he'll only go so far.
Right, we'll have some fun going to Let's knock it down and build it up.
Yeah. Right. Well, you take it through.
Through the digression there.
Uh-huh.
All right. So where we are to the digression.
You want to include the digression?
Yeah. And we need to have a look.
Yeah, I can handle digressions better. My age.
Okay, so we know where we're going?
I'm not as young as
Do we know where we've been?
Hey, well, that's right. Look here. Look here. Let me ask you a question. What would it take? What would it take to master this much? What do you have to do now? You know exactly where to go to. All of the paragraphs that puzzle you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we're very fortunate, by the way. A lot of dialogues we get into, we don't have much support. But can you? You know, the TV is so long that any of you have any questions about anything you don't mind, just check with him. Right?
Yes.
Real good. You'll right. You'll be our resident expert all the way up to this, the 160D.
He's an expert up to there.
Oh yeah.
We didn't get to the point where things can't even become, I mean, can't even say they are, did we?
No. Well, we did on one level. We just didn't go back to that.
But you're never the same. That means you're never the same. You couldn't say you were ever the same or...
Yeah, yeah, we could, right?
Know how, is all he says you can say.
Right. With the ing, you're always changing.
Yeah. So at no time could you ever say you are.
Right. And in every ing, this is emotion. By the way, so is this emotion.
But you couldn't have changed to something.
So is this emotion.
You couldn't have changed to something since at any point.
You aren't there.
You aren't there.
Yeah. All you are is different.
Yeah.
But isn't that a great defense in court?
Yeah.
Wait,
I was
the wrong guy. In fact,
we did not agree there's a difference, Your Honor, between like and unlike.
Hey, I'm not even the same.
Same difference? All right, let's go.
I mean, it couldn't have been me. I'm completely different today.
Yeah.
So I just happen to have the same name.
Yes, I just happen to have the same name at a convention.
Fact,
matter of fact, I keep
identity.
Reborn again.
Well, the letters get bigger.
Yeah. Well, now it's time for a cup, I know. I can tell it in my bones.
It isn't, it should be.
There's a little girl